Yesterday we discussed the common source amplifier using current mirror biasing, where the quiescent gate source voltage required to bias the common source amplifier is obtained by using another transistor which is diode connected and a current source is connected to the diode connected transistor. Okay, that is how we generate the quiescent gate source voltage, and we use a large resistance RG so that the signal can be added to this without attenuating it, without reducing its amplitude. Okay, otherwise the small signal resistance offered by the structure is 1 by GM and that can be a very small resistance. Okay. Essentially, to increase the input resistance of this amplifier, we use a large RG, and this is our amplifier device to which we AC couple the input signal. And on the drain side, we have the drain bias resistor RD. We need this because we have to have some path for the drain current to flow in the quiescent condition. So we need either a large inductor or a large resistor, and we connect the load. Okay. Now we know how to compute the values of all the components. In fact, this is no different from the original common source amplifier, except for the way you generate the bias. Okay. And you have to make sure that RG is much more than RS so that there is no signal attenuation. C1 is much greater than 1 by omega times RG plus RS plus 1 by GM, which is in series with it, and similarly C2 must be much greater than 1 by omega times RD plus RL. Okay. And these things are quite easy. And you can also find the quiescent drain voltage, that will be the supply voltage minus the quiescent, or rather the quiescent current in the transistor times RD. Of course, you have to make sure that this voltage is such that the transistor is in saturation region. Okay. Any questions about this structure? Any questions? Okay, I think it's a simple enough topology, and we came to these things by trying to bias a transistor at a constant current, and this particular thing and also the previous one where we had common source amplifier using drain feedback was derived from these biasing structures, where in order to bias the transistor at a given current, we sense the current difference at the drain terminal and provide feedback to the gate terminal. Okay. As I said, there are other alternatives. There are two possibilities for the location of sensing the current. The current flows from drain to source, so you can sense the difference at the drain or source. And similarly, the feedback can be applied to either gate or source, because it's the gate source voltage that controls the current. Okay. So the next one, let's say we sense the difference at the source and feedback also to the source. Okay, what we discussed so far was to sense at the drain and feedback to the gate. Okay. So I have my MOS transistor, and I of course have a current source of value I naught that's available. Just to refresh your memory, this was the connection made to sense the difference between I naught minus ID, between I naught and ID, because I naught minus ID would then flow there, and this is the feedback part. Okay. So now tell me, in this case, when you sense at the source and feedback to the source, how would I sense the difference in currents? What should I do? What is it that I should do? How should I sense the difference between the current that is flowing in the transistor, which is ID, and I naught, which is the intended current? I mean, you can use the same thing that we use for the other case and tell me what is it that I need to do. What should I do? Join which of them? Which terminal, which terminal? Let me call this A and B, and this of course is the drain, gate and source. B and drain. But I mean, I said that I want to sense the difference at the source. A and S, yeah. So if I do this, then the difference ID minus I naught tends to flow into that capacitor. That capacitor represents whatever parasitic is there at any node. And right now we are not using the drain, so I'll connect it to some high voltage. This simply means that you can assume that it will be in saturation region. Okay. And I'm not, I'm feeding back to the source, so I'll tie the gate to some fixed voltage, VG0. I could also say 0 volts. I mean, previously, if you look at it, I was feeding back to the gate and I tied the gate source to a fixed voltage, which is 0 volts. And I could do the same here, but I prefer to work with positive voltages. So I'll say this is VG0. Okay. This is fine. So this arrangement, if you connect it up like that, ID minus I naught will flow in that parasitic capacitor. Is that fine? Will it do that? Or is there some catch? It's the total capacitance that is there, and actually the capacitance does not have to be connected to ground, meaning exactly the same thing will happen. I mean, you could have capacitances to a number of different places. As long as the current tends to flow out of this node, the voltage will tend to, it will tend to flow into that plate and the voltage will tend to increase. Okay. The idea of explicitly drawing a capacitor here is, otherwise I can't even say ID is different from I naught, right? It looks like it's in violation of Kirchhoff's current law. Okay. But of course, in reality, I mean, you can easily visualize that if you have a current source and a transistor, maybe at the startup, immediately after you turn on the switch, the current in the transistor is not exactly equal to I naught. That's possible, right? So we have to be able to discuss that scenario. So I'll indicate whatever capacitance is there at the source as a single capacitance between source and ground. Okay. So now what happens if ID is greater than I naught? Or rather, we are feeding back to the source. Okay. Let me get rid of this part of it. I am feeding back to the source. So tell me, what should I do? That is, if ID is smaller than I naught, Vs, which is the voltage at the source, must do what? What should I do to the source voltage? the actual drain current is smaller than the desired drain current, okay, and the goal is to make them equal. So if actual drain current is smaller than the desired drain current, what should I do to the source voltage? Decrease it. Yeah, because I have to increase VGS. VG is fixed, so VS has to decrease. Right? And similarly, if ID is too high, ID is higher than I0, then we have to reduce the gate source voltage. Because the gate voltage is fixed, we have to increase the source voltage. Okay? Is this fine? This is what we get, this is the feedback action that we need. Okay? Now, what is it that really happens as a result of this connection which we made in order to compare currents? What happens if ID is smaller than I0? What happens to the voltage here? ID is smaller than I0. What happens? It will? I know, but what will happen to the voltage at the node? It will decrease. Increase. VS will? Yeah, VS will decrease, right? Because ID minus I0 is negative. So negative current flows this way. What happens to the voltage here? It will fall down, isn't it? It is drawing charge out of the upper plate, it will fall down. Okay? So if ID is smaller than I0, this means that the source voltage VS will decrease. Okay? Now, this is the feedback action that we want. This is what is happening because of the connection we made in order to compare the currents. So, what should we do to complete the circuit? What should I do? Again, think back to the other case we had. What should I do now? Yes, Giridhar, what should I do? Add what load? This is just the biasing arrangement, right? Where the capacitor is just a representation of whatever parasitic is there. I don't really want any extra capacitor there. Negative terminal of VGS. There is no VGS here. I'm not applying a gate source voltage, right? VG should be which point? Source of the MOS transistor. Really? Look at what I want and look at what is happening. What is it that I want? If ID is smaller than I0, what should happen to the source voltage? And what is happening if I connect this current? It is decreasing. So what do I need to do? Nothing. It will work. If you just make the connection, the feedback is already there. Okay? So, in case of drain feedback, we had to connect drain to the gate because we had to increase the gate voltage, drain voltage was increasing, we connected it up. In this case, if you examine it just for a moment, you will see that the feedback action that you want, that is, you want the source voltage to reduce if ID is smaller than I0, that is exactly what happens if this connection is made, isn't it? Okay, so you don't have to do anything. What will happen in steady state? The moment you make this connection, let's say ID is smaller than I0, what will happen? Current will be drawn out. ID minus I0 will be really flowing in the other direction. It will go on reducing VS. Okay, when will it stop? When will that voltage stop moving? When ID equals I0. Otherwise, some current will be flowing through the capacitor and steady state is not reached. Okay, so it will stop moving when ID equals I naught, and that's all that's there to it. So we have already accomplished what we wanted, which was to make I naught flow through the transistor. Okay. Isn't this a little weird? I mean, we didn't really do anything to complete feedback compared to the previous case. Previously, what did we have to do? So something was available at the drain, we had to apply feedback to the gate and we had to make that connection. Now how come we don't have to do anything? Feedback is at the source, yes, and source is, I mean, the MOS transistor is a three terminal device and source is common to the controlling side and the control side. Okay, what controls the current is the gate source voltage, and what is controlled is the current between drain and source. Okay, so source is part of both sides, controlling side and the control side, whereas gate is exclusively the controlling side and drain is exclusively the control side. So we can do this, and in a way this is the simplest way to bias the transistor at a given current. Okay, what will be this voltage here after it reaches steady state? What will be that voltage? The voltage at the source terminal. Yeah, so it's VG0 minus whatever VGS is required to support a current of I0. Okay, so it will be VG0 minus the threshold voltage minus square root 2 I0 by mu C aux, mu and C aux W by L. Okay. Fine, just like before the gate voltage got itself adjusted so that the desired drain current was flowing, now the source voltage will get adjusted. Okay. Any questions on this? And because we are feeding back to the source, this is called source feedback bias. Okay. Yeah, so how do you ensure that it is saturated? I said this is VDD, so that really means there is a voltage VDD or some voltage between that point and ground. So what is the condition required to ensure saturation? Which one? Yeah, that's right. So VDD must be greater than VG0 minus VT. Okay, so I assume that is satisfied. Where? The current source. Oh yeah, it is there. That's what you connect, right? Which two sources? VG0 is not controlling anything. What is it controlling? Okay, I mean, if you are bothered by the presence of VG0, I can set this to 0. What will happen? What will be the current in the transistor? Why? What will be the steady state current in the transistor? I0. So the only thing that will change is this will be not there. The source will be at a negative voltage. Okay. There will be some positive VGS and source will be at a negative voltage. I wanted all voltages to be positive, so that's why I connected some VG0 here, but this VG0 has no influence on the current at all. Okay. Isn't it? It's just there to set some level to the gate, that's all. Okay. Any other questions? So this connection causes the difference current to flow into any parasitic capacitor that changes this voltage, and the change in voltage automatically provides feedback because source is part of the controlling and control side. If we did have a truly like four terminal device, right, where the MOS transistor's current was controlled by the voltage difference between these two terminals, and the current was flowing between some two other terminals, that is, we had the controlling and control sides to be totally separated, then for drain feedback what we did was we connected this here and we made that connection. For source feedback you would have to do something similar, you would have to do that, okay. Now that, I mean, you can think of this connection as having already been made inside the MOS transistor, okay. So that's a pretty convenient way of biasing and pretty popular as well. So what is the next thing we'll do? Huh? I don't know. We have to define what parameters to evaluate, and then we'll see. Okay. Both will certainly, for establishing the current through the transistor, both are the same. Okay. So we have to evaluate something else. That something else will come later. I mean, maybe you can look at what is the smallest supply voltage you need to get a given gain, or maybe how large a signal you can apply without going into nonlinearity and so on. So those things will be different, and those things will be dependent on the operating point. Okay. Yeah, you tell me. You just asked the question and also answered it. So what is the condition required? I don't know, when you just tell me, I mean, all the quantities are here. What is the condition required for saturation? Okay, for VG0 minus VS, that's all. VG0 minus VT. Why VG0 minus VT? VDD minus VS must be greater than VG0 minus VT, is that what you are saying? Yeah, that should be greater than? Why VG0 minus VT? What is the condition? VDS greater than what? Huh? Ah, VGS minus VT, okay. Obviously, in many cases it's easier to evaluate this, right? If you write VDS as VD minus VS and VGS as VG minus VS, the VS drops out, and you can just look at drain and gate voltages with respect to some ground, not with respect to the source. So what is the condition? What is VD in the circuit? VDD. What is VG? VG0, right? Yeah, VDD must be greater than VG0 minus VT, that's all, okay. So you have to ensure that is satisfied. Okay, what's the next thing we'll do? I mean, we've been doing this. What's that? One is, of course, we don't want to be using multiple voltage sources. So how do I fix the situation? What should I do? No, what I think meant was we have two DC voltage sources here, VG0 and VDD. We want to reduce it to one. So, what's that? RG across what? Like this? What should I do to VG0? What should I do? What have we been doing? How did we bias the gate? Resistive divider, that's all. Okay. So that part is easy. I mean, I'm assuming VG0 is smaller than VDD, which is what is the case frequently. Okay. So some R1 and R2. And what's the next thing? We can't, why can't we just do this? Okay, so let's see. So what's the next thing we would be doing? I mean, we've been doing the same thing all the time. We want to use it as a common source amplifier. So how do I do that? The signal picture of the common source amplifier must look like that. Okay. So now do you see any problems with, I mean, in the common source amplifier, we don't have that connection between drain and gate. So even if we do this, we have to find some way of open circuiting that for signal picture. Okay. So let's say we use the resistive divider. This also gives us the freedom of choosing VG0 to be different from VDD. Okay. So what next? How should we turn this into a common source amplifier? AC couple what? The input, okay. Then, what do I do with the load? So we have the AC couple it here, but of course, this can't be shorted to VDD because it will get shorted to small signal ground. And there will be no output signal at all. So we have to have some bias resistor RD, and this may need readjustment of this VDD. Before we would have chosen VDD just to keep it in saturation. Now there is the extra drop, okay, I naught times RD. So, but I mean, you know that as I go on increasing VDD, it will move towards saturation region. I can always find some value of VDD such that it's in saturation, okay. Are we done? Are we done or what? We are? Current won't flow through I naught. So, what is the source connected to in the signal picture? Ground. Okay. What is it connected to? If I change this into its small signal equivalent circuit, what is it connected to? It's an open circuit. So how do I fix that? What's that? Yeah. How would I do this? I have to make this equal to the small signal ground in the signal picture. Okay. So again, using the same restriction of signal frequency above zero, what can I do? What is that? Capacitor in parallel to I naught. Yeah. So all I have to do is this C3, and if you choose it to be large enough, its reactance will be very small. I mean, in the signal picture, I naught will become an open circuit and you will have C3 to ground. And if you choose C3 to be large enough, its reactance will be so small that it's nearly the same as connecting it to ground for signal frequencies. That's the idea, okay. Or if you take the viewpoint that I described yesterday, when you set up the operating point, when you turn on the supply voltage, C3 will get charged to some voltage. What is that? That will be VG0 minus VGS, okay. Now if C3 is very large, then it will hold that voltage even if there are signal excursions, okay. Even if the signal is changing, this voltage across C3 doesn't change. Okay, that's the meaning of incremental ground, right, or incremental short. Incremental short between two nodes means that in the complete picture, the voltage difference between those two is fixed. Okay, there is no increment. That's what is the meaning of it. Okay, so we need an extra capacitor because in the common source amplifier, the source is connected to ground. In the source feedback structure, the source is not at ground. Okay, whereas in the drain feedback structure, the source was at small signal ground already, so we didn't have to do anything. So that way, this one seems to use more components. He was asking for comparison. So this circuit, the common source amplifier, seems to use more components than the one with drain feedback. Okay. Why? Why have RD? What else would I have? Short circuit? What will be the gain of this amplifier? assuming that the capacitors are very large, is the small signal picture of this, this one? What is the difference? To be precise, well, what happens to the drain? Where should it be connected? It will be shorted to ground, right? So, see, the whole idea behind the common source amplifier is that you, if I write the incremental equivalent with controlled sources, all of the input voltage must appear across the gate source voltage. So, that will induce a current in the control source, okay, which is GM times VGS. And all of that current should go into the load resistor, okay. So, that is why obviously we want the source to be at small signal ground and apply the signal to the gate. And similarly, all of this current must go here. And in practice, because of some other constraints, say biasing constraints, we may have extra components like RD. So, that will steal some of the current, but it is really undesirable. Okay. If possible, I would not have anything here, but this would not work. This would not work for the operating point picture, right? Because where will the current in the transistor go? So, we have to have a path for the current in the transistor. The best thing would have been to have a sufficiently large inductor. Then, if you choose it to be sufficiently large, it will really be an open circuit and all of the incremental current will flow into RL. But again, inductors being bulky, most of the time we make do with resistors. And if we do have any resistor at all, there will be current division for sure. Okay? We can't choose RD to be arbitrarily large. Why? What happens if I go on increasing RD? Yeah, you have to go on increasing VDD as well. So, that is a problem. Okay? So, that is why we need the drain bias resistor. Okay. So, this is the picture I wanted to have. Okay. And if the capacitors are large, they will be short circuits. I am not concerned with them. Yes? Yes. That is correct. That means that when you power it on, it may take a while to charge up to the right voltage. Okay. But that is okay. I mean, that is why you do not choose them to be arbitrarily large. Okay, let's say your constraint comes out that C3 is greater than 1 nanofarad, you don't go and put a 1 farad capacitor, although that will satisfy the constraint. You may put a 10 nanofarad or 20 nanofarad capacitor. By the way, so let's say you have, just imagine the circuit, no input, okay, and I power it on, right? In fact, let me remove this part completely. What will the waveform here look like? That is the output node, right? What do you think the waveform there looks like? In fact, let me simplify the circuit if you wish. Let me take the drain feedback case, okay? And I won't even show the input side of it. Okay. And I turn it on at t equal to 0. I turn it on meaning both VDD and I naught, I turn it on at t equal to 0. What will the waveform here look like? So, what will happen? What will be the value just after it is turned on? So, it will do something like that, right? I mean, if it was actually a voltage source, and C2 and RL, okay. So, then I turn on the voltage source at t equal to 0, what will the waveform look like just after t equal to 0? What is that? Okay. No, no, what is the value just after t equal to 0? Vx. So, it will jump up to Vx and fall down, okay. Of course, what is to the left side here is not an ideal voltage source. So, it actually takes some time for it to build up like that and then also fall down, okay. So, the voltage across the load does undergo a transient, and this transient will be longer and longer if the capacitor is larger. And this is also why when I turn on that PI, you hear a click, because across the loudspeaker you see this waveform, right? So when I turn on the power, there'll be, I mean, the only the signal should be going through the amplifier, but when I turn it on, you hear a pop. In most sound systems, that's the case. Okay, the reason is this: the transient in the supply. Although, I mean, I'm not connected anything to it, right? In fact, it's a very important criterion in some cases, especially with headphones. You turn it on, it could damage your ears, right? So that's why, I mean, there is like much more sophisticated startup for more sophisticated amplifiers where it will make sure that there is no click in the loudspeaker and so on. Okay. Yeah. The capacitance, I said, but yeah, resistance also will have the same effect. Really? What is the time constant? It is RC, right? Large capacitor, lot of charge, takes a lot of time to decay. Large resistor, small current, takes a lot of time to decay. That's all. Okay? So, yeah, I mean, you don't want to make them ridiculously large, but you make them large enough. Okay, so now this is the picture I wanted to have, but because of biasing constraints, I also have R1 parallel R2 and RD. As usual, this R1 and R2 can be made very large without affecting the operating point because the gate current is zero, right? So that's what I usually choose to do. I make R1 parallel R2 much more than RS. That I can do. RD, I already explained to you, you can't make it much more than RL usually because the supply voltage becomes very large. Okay? So you just live with whatever the largest value of RD that you can, and you suffer from reduction in gain because not all of the drain current will go into the resistor. Okay? Into the load resistor. Is that fine? I mean, these constraints are the same for the three different topologies we have discussed, nothing different. Okay? So now the constraints on capacitors. What is the constraint on C1? The reactance of C1 must be much smaller than what? What is that? RS plus R1 parallel R2. Again, the same as before. C2? RD plus RL. And again, if you are interested in this voltage, the drain voltage being the same as that, what is the constraint? There are two different things, right? One is C2 acting like a short circuit. That is, the output voltage being the same as if C2 is really replaced by a short circuit. The constraint for that is C2 must be much greater than 1 over omega times RD plus RL. But if I impose an additional constraint that this drain voltage has to be the same as that, what was the constraint we evaluated? 1 by omega RL. Okay. What about C3? What is the constraint on C3? Please evaluate it. How do we evaluate the constraints anyway? What is the algorithm? You can sit and evaluate the transfer function, but that's too painful. So what did we do? Oh yeah, first of all, you assume that C1 and C2 are short circuits, and then you look at what resistance appears across the capacitor and make sure that it's the reactance of the capacitor is much smaller than that. So basically find the small signal resistance that appears across C3. Any guess what that is? RD parallel RL. Okay. Anything else? Okay. Put pen to paper and give me the answer.